Hey everyone, welcome to the Zelda Informer podcast, episode number 10, I believe. This week, we have a special guest who was supposed to be here 2 weeks ago, and then bailed, again last week.
It's not my fault!
HMK is in the house.
What's up, guys? How you doing? I'm glad to be here. Thank you so much for having me.
No problem. I'm glad you could finally make it. Thought it was going to be like 2 months later. A co-host is also here, as usually. I'm not going to say as always.
As usual.
Alfred.
Yep, I'm here.
And we have our comic artist, Mr. Trey, returning yet again for his second week in a row.
How's it going, everyone?
Awesome, awesome. All right, so this week we didn't get a lot of news in terms of Zelda. But we're still going to talk about Zelda, since this is a Zelda podcast. And we're going to go through a topic we didn't quite get to last week. And that's because we don't have anything else to talk about. So that topic, it's basically how the trailer that they released for Breath of the Wild, or as it was called at the time, The Legend of Zelda for Wii U, in 2014... basically became the base for the entire game. So Eiji Onoma in an interview said that after creating the trailer, he really wanted to put that in the game. So he ended up making it come true. There's a lot I learned from that trailer. Once we'd put that element in the game, it made us think, what else can we do with this enemy? How else could we fight it? It expanded a new story idea as well, and the trailer became the basis for the whole game. And the mechanic that he's talking about is the flipping off the horse, slow motion, shooting thing in the eye. That wasn't in the game at the time. So he really wanted to get that in the game, and once they did that, they kind of used the whole trailer for everything. And what's interesting is that somehow that expanded story, I don't get that. So what do you guys think about the idea that apparently in 2014, when they were all gung-ho that this game was coming out in 2015, that suddenly that trailer like made them rethink the whole game?
Well, I remember at one point reading something along the lines of when Eiji Aonuma was explaining why the game was delayed. When reading that interview, even though my blood was boiling every time around, I'm like, we could have heard this game already. He did state that some mishaps when communicating with his team, there are things that he didn't like about the game, there are things he didn't like about the game, but when he saw things he didn't like, he would tell them, I don't like this. But when he saw things he did like, he didn't say that he liked it, so a lot of the stuff that he did like when they were developing the game ended up getting scrapped the next time he would see the team. And so I guess that...
Yeah, thanks, Eiji Onoma.
Yeah. I guess that kind of was like in that whole thing, since he's saying that, oh, we had to build this up. This is what we had in mind in 2014. So like a lot of things must have shifted along the line... Breath of the Wild's development, which is really, really weird, and I really hate when Nintendo does that, because they seem to do that a lot, especially with Twilight Princess, because there are a lot of things in the first few trailers for Twilight Princess, E3 2014, GDC 2005, no, wait, why am I saying 2014? I meant to say E3 2004, GDC 2005.
Oh, like the best unveiling of a game ever.
Right? That we saw a lot of stuff in those two trailers that we did not see in the final game, and it just makes you wonder, I'm like, what was that stuff? I just want to know what was that thing they scraped. Like, we saw that,
go ahead. Giant forest, big battle in the open field.
Right? And then the castle looked completely different. We saw, like, a giant wooden man in the middle of a forest. We saw these dungeons that we would never step foot in. I just wanted to know what that was. So I feel that's a very similar case to what's happening with Breath of the Wild. Like, there was a lot of stuff he had planned for the game around the time of 2014 and 2015, but that miscommunication that attributed to the game's delay, I feel that was because of a lot of stuff that he liked ended up getting scraped, and then he had to go back to the drawing board, and that drawing board was the E2014 trailer, and then that's the stuff he had to incorporate into the game. I feel that might have been a case, you know, that might have been something that happened.
Sure. Trey and Alfred, you got anything else to say?
This kind of reminds me of what you see in movies a lot, where what you see in the trailer, you see a bunch of scenes in the trailer that aren't don't either don't make it into the final cut of the movie, or like just for the purpose of telling a bit of a story in the trailer. I think one of the clearest examples of that I can think of is Love It or Hate It, The Amazing Spider-Man 2, where there's that one line where Harry says to Peter, "Hey, you're being investigated," or something like that, and Peter replies, "Why?" And he says, "Well, isn't that the question of the day?" That line never made it into the movie. Another more extreme examples of stuff like this, where you see big scenes that you see in a movie trailer, you're like, "Wow, I can't wait to see that in the movie," and it never happens. And so it's kind of disappointing when that happens in video games too, because you look at something like you're talking about the E3 trailer for Twilight Princess or the GDC trailer, where you look at something and you're like, "Man, I can't wait to play that," and then they change it. I think in this case, when Anuma said that whatever the game, like when they showed off the trailer for the first time at the Game Awards, I think it was, the trailer they showed was quote unquote actual gameplay. It was not scripted story. And there's a bit of buzz about that, and there was a good fan reaction to that, because they saw this like cinematic battle that technically the player had control over. And so I imagine that he saw that and was like, "Wow, we need to do more of that. We need to see more things like that that seem like they're scripted, but they're not. They're things that the player can do in a very cinematic way." And so it's kind of disappointing when we see things that don't make it into the game based on the trailers, but it's also really cool to see how sometimes the response to those trailers fuel the game. This whole thing has been in production for, we don't even know how long, could have been years before it was actually announced. It's no Last Guardian, but it has taken its sweet time in coming out, and they've made sure to tease us with a bunch of stuff, and like, "Oh, it's coming out this year. We guarantee you it's coming out this year." And we guarantee you it's coming out, no, this year. I know that we said that last year, but this year is for sure. So I don't think that if they delayed it again, they'd keep much faith with their fans. But I do like the direction that the game's going, and I'm glad to see that the response to that trailer was something that fueled it.
Yeah, I don't think we're going to have to worry about a delay. Technically, the only official statement is that it's coming out next year. So even if it doesn't launch with the NX, assuming the NX also keeps its launch period, it's still not a delay. People might think it's a delay, but it's not officially a delay.
If that game doesn't release with the NX, then that's going to be a major.
Yeah, I don't know why I won.
Yeah, that's going to be a huge miss opportunity in order to give the NX.
It's like, this is the only game they showed off at E3. I went to E3, played the thing 6.5 times, and then, yeah, let's not release it when the NX comes out.
All us Nintendo fanboys would just cry.
Man,
we need that for the NX.
That would be so disappointing.
Right, because hey, Sony, they have to get this. Wait, someone's new?
No, I'd switch to Sony at that point.
Oh, okay. Oh. I thought you were gonna
look at that.
But man,
that's the straw that'll break everyone's back. Nintendo, hope you're listening. Don't launch it outside of the NX launch window.
They're not listening
because you're gonna lose everyone.
I mean, because like you saw what happened with Twilight Princess being released for the Wii as launch title. That helped the sales a lot, and they can't repeat what they did with Wii U. And I love the Wii U to death. I love my Wii U, but I mean, the launch lineup was so ass.
What
like,
launch lineup?
Terrible. I know. What like Just Dance?
Hey, here's another Super Mario game.
See, I'm okay. I know this is a little bit off topic, but you brought it up. I wrote an editorial on this before the Wii U came out, and I actually went through the launch lineup for every Nintendo system, every PlayStation, every Xbox, every Sega system ever released. The Wii U's actual launch lineup isn't that bad. In fact, it's better than most systems' launch lineups. It's that they didn't have like a killer game. As an example, when the N64 came out, it literally had one game at launch. But that one
game
was Super
Mario
64.
That's all they needed.
It was like a killer game. Yeah. So it didn't necessarily have a killer game, but most console launches don't have a killer game. Most console launches sometimes don't even have exclusive games. It's actually kind of crazy because I was just like you before the Wii U coming out. I really wasn't that excited about the launch lineup. And then I started looking at it. I'm like, you know, this launch lineup isn't really that bad. At the time, Zombie U was exclusive. it had the new version, or it was an old version of Madden, but whatever. A new version of Madden coming out at the time. It had the current Call of Duty game coming out. It had
Assassin's Creed 3.
Assassin's Creed. Like, it actually had, like, a really solid lineup for launches. And then, like, the exclusive games, they got, like, 4 or 5 exclusive games, including, obviously, the Mario game, which I think is still a really good game.
I love that
game. Just,
all right, yo.
That franchise, that the new Super Mario Bros. Franchise seems, like, kind of overdone.
I thought the one that came out with the Wii U was the Super Mario World.
Nah, it was new.
That came out that holiday.
If it was that one, it
would came out that holiday.
I retract my statement.
The new one.
I like that one better than new Super Mario Bros.
Yo, check this. Yeah. Check this. Like, all of Nintendo's consoles since the Super Nintendo, home consoles have had a killer game. The Super Nintendo had Super Mario World. Come on, and N64, as you said, Super Mario 64. The GameCube had Super Smash Bros. Melee. People were dying for that game. Wii, Twilight Princess. So, like, the Wii U, new Super Mario Bros. U is not up to standard. I mean, yeah, the games weren't bad, but they weren't amazing. And I'm like, you need to strike the iron while you have to strike the iron while it's hot with the NX. They need to have Breath of the Wild as a launch title, or, you know, get ready for the loss of sales. But, I mean, Kimishima, I believe in Kimishima because he's a businessman first and then a president. He's like the first business savvy president we've ever had in Nintendo. And I believe him saying that the reason why they pushed back the NX to launch, because apparently they rumor has they had it ready for holiday season this year, but they decided to push it back in order to have titles. And when he said that, because March is a very weird launch month for a console.
There's tax returns. So
you're
probably like banking
too.
On that.
It's tax return season, and on top of that, it's just before the end of the fiscal year.
Right.
So it's actually like, if they're going to launch the NX and they want their, because they already had like a really bad Q1. If they want to show optimism to their investors, like, it can't be, oh, well, we have the NX coming out later this year. No, it has to be optimism now. They need to see the NX is actually going to sell.
Right.
And even at launch, it's going to sell a couple million because Nintendo always sells a couple million at launch. So it's probably going to look good either way.
Yeah, because, I mean, like,
if they get it out then.
But I'm really curious to see what these launch titles are, because Nintendo was so confident in pushing this thing back to March. I really want to know what this is. And come September, hopefully we'll get the final reveal of the NX, what it is. And, you know, we can see Breath of the Wild amongst that launch lineup. Because, man, I need to be wowed by this launch lineup. They better just bust out the Breath of the Wild, bust out a new Kirby, bust out an F-Zero,
Luigi's
bust out
Mansion
Pikmin
3.
4, bust out Super Mario Galaxy 3. They need to just destroy.
The dream lineup.
The dream lineup.
So, just a correction, because I remember when I was doing that editorial about the launch lineups, Nintendo has traditionally had pretty strong lineups, but Melee was not a launch game.
It came out
the year after.
No.
Their big game at launch was Luigi's Mansion.
And that was a fantastic freaking game.
It was a fantastic game, but it wasn't a system seller.
It should have been. That game is
should have been,
underrated.
But it wasn't. I'm just literally going through the DS also did not have any killer
launch
games.
It had Metroid Prime Hunters.
Metroid Prime Hunters. Super Mario 64 DS ended up being like the best selling launch game. That was just a remake. Obviously we all know the Wii story and the Wii U story. So it's really mostly the I believe the Game Boy Advance, the Super Nintendo, and the NES all had pretty stacked launch lineups.
See, but if you think about it, Nintendo has never really had, like, there's no real consistency with them.
Boy, I guess if, you know, they had
Wait
Texas
a minute. Wait
and
a minute.
Super Mario Land.
What, Melee came out a month after GameCube's release.
Was it a month after?
Yeah. When that
So it was within the launch window, but
yeah.
It wasn't a launch game. Yeah,
man, good enough, man. I will wait a month to get Melee. Fuck that.
You're just like, good enough.
Right?
I'm just saying, like, you know, a launch, like, I know Nintendo likes doing this launch window stuff, but technically launch lineups are what's available when
right,
day one.
Right, I feel like.
But that's not really
so
what
yeah,
Zelda
but yeah,
consoles,
but GameCube did. GameCube, just like the Wii. Like, the Wii had Twilight Princess, obviously, but, like in the months after it, it had, like, killer game after killer game coming out. Like, nonstop for that first year. So they really kept the momentum with core gamers, especially. Obviously, the casuals were eating up Wii Sports, plus, you know, Wii Fit, Just Dance, all that stuff that was coming out at the time. Still coming out today, Just
Man,
Dance. Apparently,
just,
still sells.
I just want to know what Nintendo's thought process was with the Wii and the game lineup. I'm like, man, this thing is so dry. Like, compared to all the other systems, like, man.
I think it was like Ubisoft has their back, so, you know, we could just put this out. Right. And we get Scribblenauts.
Yeah, well, that's actually one reason I already have. I believe, I know some people don't want to believe Tatsumi Kimishima when he said that, you know, the NX didn't come out this holiday because they wanted to make sure they had enough games, not just at launch, but, like, in the first year. And I'm just like, yeah, that actually makes sense. Because look at what just happened with the 3DS and the Wii U.
Oh,
3DS
there was
big
bad.
Dry spells. Like, at the beginning. The Wii U's was worse than the 3DS, because at least the 3DS had, like, Ocarina of Time 3D.
Oh, we even had to wait for
that.
That
wasn't a launch title. Yeah.
I remember I had to play, like, Samurai Warrior Chronicles, and I was, like, just
yeah,
three more
was,
months
was, like,
just shaking,
like,
three
the
more
launch
months.
Games were not that great.
You had Street
and then they
Fighter.
Had nothing.
And then,
yeah,
like, Super Monkey
Fighter.
Ball, Ridge Racer, and not
Madden.
A lot of good games. I don't think there
yeah,
were any
then,
first-party
no,
launch titles for the 3DS.
Were there none? I thought they
I
had.
I don't remember any.
Well, they had the AR.
They had exclusives
games.
like the Samurai Warrior Chronicles,
Wings,
but that was it.
Steel Driver,
yeah, Pilot
and
Wings.
Dogs.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
But none of those are like. None of those were like, oh man, I have to go buy a 3DS because Nintendogs plus Cats is out.
Right.
That's true. Yeah, it's been an interesting period. So hopefully they nail it with the NX launch. They have no reason not to at this point. We haven't had Wii U games for essentially a full year. Plus, NX games probably started development at least 2 years ago. The launch lineup games, that is. And I'm really hoping that they just nail it out of the park. We'll see. Hopefully the September rumors are true and we finally see what this thing is and what their plans are. We'll move on to our next topic. So, earlier this week, I think it was this week, I wrote an editorial talking about art style in the Zelda series. And how the Zelda series constantly changes the art style all the time. And whether or not that's a good or bad thing. And how it is compared to, like, gameplay and what's more important. So, the topic I want to raise here, and I'm not going to say much about it because I've said a lot already, is how important do you guys think art style is for the Zelda series?
Everything.
Yeah.
It's everything.
It's everything. For me,
it's
everything.
That's a pretty bold
statement. That is
evil.
I would
say being an artist, it's everything to me. I'm sorry. I gotta... It sets the tone. So, like, with Twilight Princess, they have this serious, like, you know, it's like a dark kind of theme tone art style, whereas, like, Wind Waker has this cel-shaded. I don't think it would work very well if they were like, oh, let's give Wind Waker this really dark, you know, tone. And
my counter to that, what if the gameplay just sucks?
I mean, I still think it's everything, because think about, like, a game like Kirby's Epic Yarn, right? Certain people look at that and be like, I'm not playing this. It's
oh,
Yarn, it's this, it's that. And yeah, exactly, it's a great game. I think that a lot of people look at it and they'll make their judgment before they actually play it based on the art style.
Sure, that's true.
Yeah, but I mean, when we're talking about Zelda, it's come to the point where, like, all you need to say is Zelda, and that's already a huge draw in itself.
You
I
could
feel...
say Zelda CDI, though. I mean,
first of all,
art style is everything.
First
I'm sorry.
First of all, those games are not called The Legend of Zelda. It's just Link's Faces of Evil and Zelda Wand of Gamelon and Zelda.
But Triforce Heroes is called The Legend of Zelda.
Yeah,
that
and
is
you know,
true.
I really don't hate that game as much as a lot of people are hating
it. I don't dislike it either, but it did not sell.
I bought it and returned it. Like a day after I got
Damn.
It.
Damn. Oh.
Actually, I
love Triforce Heroes.
I thought
it's
the level design
five.
Was really great in that game. I really love the dungeons in
Triforce. It felt like
Heroes.
A really short demo for a 3D Four Swords Adventures. So I was like,
well, short? I mean, it's like...
That game is longer than A Link Between Worlds.
No, I know. It just... It like, the levels felt short. Like, they're all based... I'm not going to get into that. Never mind.
Oh, yeah. No, you have to play it longer.
Triggered. That's, okay.
As you get deeper into it, the levels get a lot longer.
But going back to art style, I do... I get what he's saying about how it's everything, but I wouldn't say it's everything. I would say it's a very, like, one of the most important things. Like if it had to be boiled down to three core things of Zelda, it would be one of those three core things. And it's definitely art design, because, I mean, you have, like he said, you have to, you when it comes to choosing your art design and how well you present it, that is what conveys the message of the game or conveys the gameplay of the game itself. Like, you know, Wind Waker, it's not going to look good, or I don't think it's going to play good if it had the Twilight Princess design and vice versa. But, you know, it's that design that has to help show gamers what this game is capable of doing gameplay-wise and story-wise. It has to be that delivery.
It's that backbone, I think.
Yeah, there you go. It's a good backbone. I wouldn't say it's everything, but it is a big backbone, especially with those other streams. Because, I mean, you can't really ask that question with something like, you know, Mario or Metroid or something like that, because they had a pretty consistent art style or pretty consistent style to their games, with some slight variations here and there. But Zelda is always changing. Zelda is always evolving. The only thing that is constant in Zelda, I would say, is the
story.
Fluid the story and the fluid character designs in themselves. You know, we know what Link looks like. You can draw him in any type of style, but we know it's like, okay, that's Link. You know, oh, that's Zelda. Okay, that's Ganondorf. You know, but when it comes to the art styles, it's always evolving. It's ever fluid. And that is a very important thing in Zelda. So I do believe it's like it's the backbone. I wouldn't say it's like it's not everything, because I believe that gameplay is everything for Zelda. But it's definitely a backbone. You know, something very important, something that cannot sleep on.
So, I art style is it's important.
I think we changed Nate's mind.
No, you haven't. No, art style is important.
That takes a miracle, Trey.
Right?
No, my mind has been changed a lot. I almost put a Zelda game above Zelda 2 on my favorite list.
Was it Triforce Heroes?
No, but Triforce Heroes did make my top 5.
I'm sorry, I don't like that game. I try.
I know you don't. It's okay. Most people don't like Zelda 2 either.
I love that game, but I just can't.
I'm used to people hating the games I like. Maybe I just have bad taste. That's what it is. Like, a lot of people love Ocarina of Time. I just think it's, yeah, it's all right.
No, don't start. Just let him finish.
Don't start that up.
See, I love Skyward Sword, and a lot of people don't like Skyward
Sword. I love Skyward Sword. I love Ocarina of Time. I think Ocarina of Time is number one to me, and Skyward Sword is number two. And a lot of people are like, what? And I'm like, yeah, I adore Skyward Sword.
I think Ocarina of Time for me is like number 15.
What? Oh boy.
Oh, yeah. Let's not start. Let's not start.
No. So art style obviously matters. I think art style invokes feelings in players, especially when you talk about like hype levels. Just think about that Wii U tech demo that where we're never gonna see a game in that style.
I'm a bit salty about that.
It became like the most talked about thing at E3 that year. Despite other consoles or despite other games, and despite the fact it was just a tech demo. And it was like the most tweeted about thing out there.
It was like Space World all over again.
Yeah, kind of. Well, Twitter wasn't around back then, but if it was, it would have been like that. The internet was abuzz as much as it could be before social media.
Yeah, we just sent carrier pigeons back and forth back then.
Yeah,
I think art style matters. It's definitely important. But I also think the Zelda series does this weird thing, okay? It's really unique in that there isn't really a singular visual identity for the series. They will experiment with whatever art style they think fits whatever gameplay design that they're doing. So I think, like what Trey was talking about with art style and, like, you know, being this big, important thing, I think it's more so the art style, they do it as a complementary feature to their gameplay. They don't really build it as, we have to do this art style, and let's build a game around it. And there's aspects to look at it. Like, take the Wind Waker. The big reason the Wind Waker does what it does is because, at the time, they really couldn't get the technology in the GameCube to render the sea fast enough to do it in any other art style. Like, they were kind of forced into a certain direction And then they experimented with that direction, ended up enjoying it. I ended up loving it. A lot of us did. Some people still don't like it. Too bad. It happened. and it got remade and looked even better. So suck it.
Well, let me pose a question real quick. Say, sure. If like the new Zelda, not, you know, like they make a new one down the line and it has the art style of, say, Mad World. How would you feel about that?
That's, dude, I'm imagining right now that shit was balling.
But see, I liked Mad World.
Me
but,
too.
I mean, I'm not hating on Mad World, but I'm just saying,
you're not.
Like,
it's just a drastic change.
It's one of those things that you like, okay, that's a drastic change. You see the art style, and then you think about it, and you sit on it, and you're like, well, let me see the gameplay afterwards. Like, I feel like seeing, like, Mad World, you're gonna kind of question yourself and be like, really? Like, you know, I don't know, that's just how I feel.
I was always hoping for a
I've never felt
Zelda.
That way with Zelda games. Like, I'll see a Zelda game unveiled, I'll look at the art, and I might be like, eh, I'm not really feeling it. But then I keep reminding myself, it's a Zelda game. Just play it, see what you think. Like, when The Wind Waker was unveiled, that was back in 2002? Or was it 2001?
It was 2002.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I would have been 16. And I remember looking at it and being like, well, I'm kind of let down because I thought it was going to be something like Space World, which looked like an evolution of Ocarina of Time. So I was kind of let down. But I was like, but it's Zelda. Like, it's not going to suck. It can't suck.
Uh-huh.
I've never, at that point, I had never played a Zelda game I didn't love.
And then you found Triforce Heroes.
I love Triforce Heroes. So, anyways. So I gave it a shot. I tried. I bought it day one, gave it a shot, and I loved it. It was great. The art style, it was definitely, I went into it thinking it was going to be like a children's version of Zelda, and came out of it after the story completed and everything, and I'm like, okay, yeah, no kid's going to get this.
Yeah, like that game is
like,
way darker than
it's very adult. A lot of adult things are covered in that game, and it made me kind of realize, as I look back on the series and the whole art style and why it matters so much, is I still take issue that a lot of the times I think their art direction choices have been based on the hardware they're making the games on more than it's been based on what they think visually looks best with a game. Like, I already mentioned, like, the Wind Waker choice was made because of they wanted to do this ocean thing and it just wasn't going to work with how they wanted to do it on the GameCube in a different art style. In Twilight Princess, that was a reaction to fans in North America who were upset with the Wind Waker art style. And actually, the current president of Nintendo was the one who told Eiji Nomura, no, you cannot make the Wind Waker 2. Like, you can't do that. People are not going to like it. And that's what led to Twilight Princess. And that was a reactionary because that's a popular fantasy art style. And it sold really, really well, got people super hyped, yada, yada, yada. And then Skyward Sword came out. Well, Skyward Sword was doing these things with motion controls, and they were on a system that wasn't in HD. And if they went for a similar style to Twilight Princess, which is how they started development, it wasn't going to look a lot different from Twilight Princess. So it actually was going to make the Wii itself not look that powerful, because it's still making a game in 2011 that looks like a game in 2006. So, like, they needed to do an art direction that looked better without being in HD and didn't necessarily get direct comparisons to a game they've done before. Hence, they went with the painter style, which looks, I think, beautiful on the Wii. It looks even better in HD. But, I mean, at the time, I didn't know any better. Never saw it on emulator, and I thought it was awesome. Now we have Breath of the Wild. And Breath of the Wild has to deal with the limitations of the Wii U. It's this huge, massive open world game, and it's trying to do all this stuff in it, and I don't think if they went with a different art direction, let's say they went with a more Twilight Princess-esque art direction, I don't think they could do all the stuff they're doing with this game.
I think it would take too long.
You know, honestly,
that's kind of why I'm stuck, because I'm kind of like, I think their art directions aren't really chose for the reasons that people think they're chosen.
Right, right.
I think it's hardware-based. They have to do certain things. And then if Zelda starts tanking, which they felt like it was with the Wind Waker, then they're like, oh man, okay, we got to go back and just like go with this, the style everyone expects, because that's going to sell.
Well, it's this weird pattern then, because they make the game based on the hardware limitations of one console, and then people don't like that, so they base the next game around the graphics that they're trying to build, and then people don't like that, so then they go back to what they had originally.
Well, it's not that people didn't like that. Like, obviously, Twilight Princess, I believe, if you combine the sales for GameCube and Wii, it is the best-selling Zelda game of all time.
Yeah. But there were a lot of fans that didn't like it.
Yeah, there's people who didn't like Ocarina of Time, like me.
Like you.
People not liking something, we're in the age of the internet. The vast majority of people that played Twilight Princess loved Twilight Princess. Like, it was very well-worded. I remember at the time, the hype building up to it, the release, and how excited most fans that I saw on social media things were. There were always critics, but they were, like, a vast minority that just wouldn't shut up. And you could tell by the user reviews on Game Critic at the time, and, like, users were rating this game super high. Plus, all the media outlets were giving it, like, 4 out of 5s, 5 out of 5s. What confused me about Twilight Princess is it was so successful sales-wise that I think they didn't know what to do with art style after that. Because, as I said, the Wii just, it was basically a GameCube. I mean, it was technically more powerful than a GameCube. It was, in all comparison, you could look at GameCube games, look at Wii games, show them side by side, ask people which console they're on, and unless they played the games and knew, they might not be able to tell you.
Hmm.
You know, because sometimes you'd see control prompts on the screen. But, like, if they had no background for the system, they just looked at them, you know, look at the visuals, tell me, what game is this from, or what system was it on? They might not even know. I think art style is important, is more important, I think, to the fans than I really think that it is important to Nintendo.
I think it works with the theme of the Zelda series, because we talked about this, I think, last podcast, two podcasts ago, whatever it was, how each Zelda game, this was about the rebooting the Zelda series, how each Zelda game is basically a reboot. And it's always, sure. It's almost always different, the same premise, same tropes, but it's different characters or different Zelda, different Link. And so the art style kind of reflects that. The fact that each game is different in some way than the other. Aside from, like, you know, direct sequels like, Phantom Hourglass or Majora's Mask. Like, aside from those few exceptions, most of the games reflect the fact that each game is different. And I don't think that that's necessarily a bad thing. And I honestly don't think we've had... Okay, I'm ignoring the CDI games because you're going to bring that up. I don't think that there's been a bad-looking Zelda game or Legend of Zelda game. I just think that people expect one thing, and then they get another thing. And while they don't think that they want it, they do, or they like it. Because I didn't have any expectations going into Wind Waker when I first got it. I only knew that it looked different, and it didn't look like the Zelda games that I was familiar with, but it was great. It's one of my favorite Zelda games. And so you kind of have to go into it with that mindset of, you know, each Zelda game is different. They're all going to have this different thing that sets them apart from each other. Like, you know, the art styles for one, or the controls or whatever. but that kind of is reflective of the series. You know, how we have different art styles, different characters. And so I don't think it's necessarily a bad thing. I don't think it's... part of me agrees that it's very, very important. The other part's like, it's not that important because... You know, there are still some games that are good, and they don't have, like, the best graphics for, you know, whatever console they're on. I don't think that's ever been a problem.
When I think... It's weird for me, because art styles matter to so many people. And there hasn't really been an art style for Zelda that they've come out with that I didn't end up enjoying and end up loving. And I think a lot of that's just because the gameplay is so great. So fantastic. That the art style just works. Like, in Wind Waker, the art style feels right when Link is flying around in the air with his counters. Like, the art style just feels like it belongs. Because that's not something that would maybe look as good if it was, say, in, like, a Twilight Princess type art style. Because in Twilight Princess art style, you do have some, like, finishing blows and stuff where you move, but it's not nearly as whimsical feeling. Yeah, I don't know. To me, it's always been gameplay first. That is how the games are made. art style matters. I think if they had a more consistent art style, the series actually might sell more game to game.
I think art style greatly impacts. That.
Yeah, yeah, that's okay. It's okay to disagree.
I'd say that
like if they had stuck with Twilight, like let's say that the art style for this game was the Wii U tech demo, I think it would be even more hyped for.
Yeah, but that was still slightly different than Twilight Princess.
It was slightly, but it looked like a natural progression.
Yeah. I mean, I don't think that that's necessarily like
if that's even possible on the Wii U. Rumors that it might not be able to even like that tech demo they said might not even be able to run on the retail Wii U.
I don't think so.
Someone was examining it. They were saying it was running on some dev unit that had a more powerful processor or something.
That wouldn't surprise me at all. I just don't think that necessarily people look at games like that. I don't think people necessarily look at Nintendo games like that. They might look at games like Uncharted or Assassin's Creed.
The thing is, this is the one series Nintendo has that appeals to those fans. Zelda crosses boundaries. Like, a lot of Nintendo games, I would agree with you on this point, but, like, Zelda is one of those games that just... If you like adventure games, action-adventure games, you will like Zelda if it's in a style that's appealing to you.
Well, I think that people associate Nintendo... Okay, this may not be the best thing to say now, but people associate Nintendo with a quality game. Generally, that's true.
Hey, Reggie Fils-Aimé just said, hey, I know the Wii U's life cycle is coming to an end, but we do have the highest reviewed games this generation.
They have good quality games, and I don't think people look at, despite the art style for a Zelda game, and they're like, oh, I don't know if that's going to be good, because they have the same type of reputation as Naughty Dog or other companies that have like these I don't know any other game company that has a series running as long as Legend of Zelda or Mario or something, but they're generally
there's very few.
They're generally well received despite whatever graphics they may have or may not have or art style, and so I don't think that necessarily determines the game for some people. I think it might turn people off initially, but
initial impressions can be everything.
That's true.
I think it is everything. Like Yoshi's Woolly World, some people look at that and they're like, oh, it's yarn. And then they're like, I'm not going to do it. Like, I like the old, style of, Yoshi's Island, and, I don't like this new one. I think some people, they do judge, depending on, if they see it. But Zelda's a little different, like you said, because they feel
especially
so invested into it.
I think they react that way, especially if it's a franchise that has pre-built expectations. Like, Yoshi has kind of always looked a certain way.
That's true.
Kirby always looked a certain way. And now they look completely different, and people don't like that.
But Zelda's always kind of looked different.
Which, in response to Epic Yarn's bad sales, they have made, two really good Kirby games since. Don't remember, Epic Yarn was a really good Kirby game.
It deserves way more recognition than it got.
Like, I know some people are like, oh, but you can't die. I'm like, just play the game. just play it. Get past the first few stages. The game is magical.
The music in that game is, oh my gosh.
Yes.
It's perfect. All
right, so obviously we spilled over a little bit to the next segment. That's okay, because we only have one person with Fan Topics, and it's a person from last week. So Jose Bentecourt from our Facebook page asked a little four-question thing. I think they all kind of follow each other pretty well. So the first one he asked, this is a good one since we have the hype man himself.
Hey.
After Breath of the Wild, how do we speculate what is in store for the series?
Okay, so all right,
go for it.
Oh no! What were you gonna say?
No! I already lost my train of thought. As soon as you said okay, I'm over. He's about to go. The hype man's all bringing it.
All right. So as everything with Zelda games, and this even is prevalent with Breath of the Wild and going off of a game like Skyward Sword. Okay, we can use. So much stuff, especially since Breath of the Wild is going to be such a huge game. I'm pretty sure there's going to be a lot of lore connecting past Zelda games and potentially future Zelda games in the chronology. As we can see here, for some weird reason, there is a like a trend going on with the fascination of the goddess Hylia that was introduced in Skyward Sword. You know, we thought that she was going to be a one-time deal, you know, one and done, because at the end of the game, spoilers, she does become Zelda, and that was the first ever game in the chronology. Yet we have like Hyrule that was already built up and then torn down, and Hylia, it seems to be a big deal once again in Breath of the Wild. And that's one thing that we can use in Breath of the Wild, looking towards future Zelda games. You know, we can learn certain things. What is Calamity Ganon? How he became Calamity Ganon? Why was he locked away in the castle? Sheikah, for crying out loud! We're going to learn more about the Sheikah, finally! Mm-hmm. This race, or I should say, this clan in the series has been... They've been the personification of the men behind, or not even men, but like, you know, like people behind the curtain. They've been behind the scenes in every single Zelda game, you know, helping the royal family, helping, aiding the fight against evil. Yet we hardly know anything about them other than they serve the goddess, and now the goddess has become Zelda, and now they serve the royal family because of that. That's all we know. We always know they're on the brink of extinction in almost every game they've been in. We know that, they're loyal to the royal family, and now we have Sheikah amongst it. This is the most amount of Sheikahs I've seen in this in a Zelda game, and the game hasn't even come out yet. You know, there are so many things we can use to theorize in the future of Zelda, story-wise. Gameplay-wise, same deal. You know, combat and everything has been evolving up until Zelda, up until each Zelda game that would come after every Zelda game. I'm kind of, like, repeating myself, but, you know, that's such a good question. And this is, I feel that this is a good answer, because there are so many things we can go off of when theorizing what could be in the future of Zelda in terms of story, in terms of gameplay, and in terms of a character development and their past and potentially their future. Up until Skyward Sword, we always knew Zelda was kind of special. You know, she's a princess of Hyrule. She has magical abilities, wielded the Triforce of Wisdom. But up until Skyward Sword, we really didn't know why she was so damn special. Now we know she's the reincarnation of a goddess. That's crazy. And now it's the same shit with Ganondorf. You know, why is this man in particular always coming back? Why is he always coming back and, you know, starting shit in Hyrule? Now we know why. He is an incarnation of Damiya's hatred that will always follow Zelda and Link to the ends of the earth, which is sad, but it's something that we know and we discover. We can discover so many secrets of the past of past Zelda games, and from little, like, you know, secrets and tidbits that we learn in Breath of the Wild, we can use that and expect and theorize on what we can get in future Zelda games. Same thing as we done with Skyward Sword. We are getting a lot of things yelling back from Skyward Sword and Breath of the Wild, and that's nuts. And not only Breath of the Wild, we're getting things from Ocarina of Time days. We're getting things from Twilight Princess days. We're getting things from, you know, people are theorizing, hey, this could be Hyrule after the water receded. Things from Wind Waker days. You know, there are so many things we can go off of into the future of Zelda. And this is just, you know, scratching the surface. The game is not even out, for crying out loud. And yet this is all we were able to gather this much. Imagine when the game comes out. So yes, there is a lot of ways we can go into the future of Zelda games theorizing, and that's my answer.
Are you not entertained?
I'm sorry.
Yeah, you said a lot there. That's good. Yeah. I knew you'd be perfect. I saved this question for you.
thank you.
So there's a couple things that I kind of look at when I look at the future of the series, because the producers and the creator of the series have kind of talked about this. Like, Miyamoto said something about a game. Like, he talked to Eiji Onoma about a game involving Sheik. And that might be, like, more of a spin-off game. Because it sounds like they've confirmed that Link's always going to be the star of the main games. So they could do, like, a side game showing the 7 years in Ocarina of Time.
Oh, my gosh.
Which, that would be fantastic. And that's something that would be...
Didn't he talk about, like, a thief-themed game?
Yeah, that was a new IP.
I know, but what if
the new IP is
Sheik?
Oh, it's not going to be that.
What if it is, though?
It's not going to be that.
It technically wouldn't be a new IP. That's
that wouldn't be. It'd be a spin-off game. That's not a new IP.
What if they spell it that?
But like the key word, like new IP, like it means it can't be related to Zelda because that's not a new IP. People want it to be, but like Eiji Onoma has said for years now, he's been wanting to do something besides Zelda, so... I don't know. Anyways, we talked about that in a prior podcast. Maybe we'll get back to that in the future if we ever figure out what this game is that he may or may not be working on with this may or may not be finalized thief idea. Another thing that Eiji Onomu brought up is that he could see himself making another game like Breath of the Wild in the future. At least one more game like it. So it kind of sounds like to me when he said that, that they have ideas already in store for what the next big Zelda game is going to be. And if it's going to take place, you know, it could even be like a sequel to Breath of the Wild. You know, something that takes place after, like Breath of the Wild sets the stage and everything kind of ends with Calamity Ganon maybe of the game, but there's still so much, like HBK is bringing up all these possibilities for branching off and story elements. It could be really easy for them to follow that up with another game. And reuse the engine, kind of go Majora's Mask style there. Or Triforce Hero style, whatever. Whichever way you want to go with it. Reusing assets and, you know, coming up with another big, you know, open world game that doesn't take 5-6 years to develop. And I think in many fans' minds, they would love that. A game that is built on the same engine as Breath of the Wild, the same visuals, maybe completely enhanced because it's on NX. You know, maybe they find new ways to make the engine even better. But then it only takes 2 to 3 years, and they get it out, and it's a sequel, and everyone's happy.
Well, most people.
But maybe he said he would like to make one more game like it. Doesn't mean that game's going to come right away. And like if NX is what the rumors claim it is, you know, primarily a handheld device that also works with your TV. You know, chances are that the next Zelda game might be like another top-down one or something to that nature that's more for taking on the go. That also looks obviously fantastic on your TV. So, yeah, there's a lot of ways you could speculate for the future of the series. Obviously, we'll be able to speculate even more once we get to play Breath of the Wild. Thank you so much for that. We're gonna keep answering your fan questions because I don't want to have your fan questions leak into next week as well. So we'll cut our last segment a little short. So Jose Bentecourt also asked if it would spawn extra expansions and how will the new system change gaming for other Nintendo games. So we kind of covered the idea of like side games, you know, like the Sheik game. Do you guys have any thoughts on how Breath of the Wild could impact other franchises?
Can see Nintendo... And this is my hope. This is my dream. I know that there's like a slim chance of it actually happening, but from what it sounds like from Breath of the Wild, they're going for a more story-focused game, which you don't see a lot from Nintendo, at least like, you know, the main series Nintendo, like Mario. There's really no story. Like Bowser kidnaps the princess, and then you go save her. Sometimes there's other things involved. There's not a lot of like. Continuity or story there, but I can see Nintendo maybe either making a new IP with story in it or just coming up with new ways to breathe new life into other games because of Breath of the Wild. But like my hope is that they take what they've learned from Breath of the Wild, you know, a big expansive game, new mechanics, to try something new, to go with a more story-focused game because, you know, honestly, that's what's really popular these days. Even some of the side-scrollers that are coming out have a story to them, like a big story. Like, Limbo's a side-scroller, right? You'd consider that a side-scroller?
Yeah.
That's got a story to it. And so, not that Nintendo's getting left behind because they are still their own company that, you know, still produces, you know, AAA quality games. But I'd like to see them take the idea from this of adding story to their games and flesh them out a bit, as opposed to, oh, well, we don't need story because this game is good. It's got good gameplay. It's like, okay, but we can make that better.
In many ways, I hope that's what they have Retro Studios working on.
A new IP?
Like, just like a new IP.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, a lot of people have been wanting them to do one forever, but like a new IP that is more Western in that it focuses heavily on story. Because I don't think we're ever going to get that kind of IP out of Nintendo EAD. I think you're going to get, you know, more games like Splatoon, which are fantastic, by the way.
Was Monolith Soft Nintendo EAD, or was it like an offshoot?
It's an offshoot. It's a different company that Nintendo bought majority stake in. So, like, it's like a, they call it a second party developer.
Yeah, yeah.
But, yeah.
So, because that game has, it's not the best story, but it's very story focused, very character.
Yeah, very story focused. Yeah. That was well, what... I mean, and it's an RPG, a Japanese RPG. Yeah.
But it so has it has a lot of Western influences in it.
That particular game, yes. The prior game doesn't.
No, it doesn't. But Xenoblade Chronicles X for the Wii U.
And I think they said they weren't going to make the next one Western focused. They were going to go back to Japanese.
But it was so good.
Right?
Well, that's it. They keep going back and forth. Like, just combine it all into one.
Yeah. Make a...
Not Japanese, not Western. Make it
a RPG.
If make Nintendo it international. Can invent, if Nintendo can change open world to open air, you can invent your own... Your own RPG genre. It's okay. So, just to make sure we get to his other questions, Jose Bentecourt also wants to know what our thoughts are on if there was a Pokemon game as massive as Breath of the Wild. Like, if that ever happened.
Pokemon Go.
That's probably more massive.
Like,
it's the biggest
really
open world game ever.
I really want a Pokemon MMO.
Oh.
A lot of people do.
We'd never leave the house. We'd undo everything Niantic just did.
No, I think how they can make it work is Pokemon is so unique. They could actually make it, especially if they're working on some unified OS thing, that they could actually make it where there is a game, you play it, you go battle, but like you can actually combine it with Pokemon Go and go out in the world and catch Pokemon to bring them into your game. And that maybe that's how you catch Pokemon.
You're living in a catch utopia. Them in the game.
You have to go out in the world to get your Pokemon, but then you bring them into the game, and that's where you could like battle all your trainers, go in all the tournament modes, and there could still be an expansive world in that game. That you know, maybe you do catch some Pokemon in there, like maybe, like you know, you go outside to get the original 151, but you could play the game to get the other 600 or whatever.
Pokemon like there's a Stadium way that they can split Coliseum. It up.
They already do that with Pokemon games, right? If you want all the Pokemon, you got to buy both games, or know someone who has the other game, or cheat. They have that trade system now, so I guess you don't even have to know anyone anymore. That online trade system.
Yeah, the Wonder Trade thing.
Yeah. So I guess maybe it's not as complicated as it used to be when I was growing up. But the idea is that like so you have to have at least two people with the both versions of the game. To be able to kind of collect them all, as they say. And I think if they were to do an MMO, they could still do the Niantic outdoor thing and combine it with the indoor MMO experience. I think Pokemon is like that one unique franchise you could actually pull that off with.
But I don't know if they're confident enough.
And it builds out the Pokemon Go phenomenon if for some reason it still matters by then. I don't know, a lot of people are upset right now with the recent update.
Okay, in its defense, the game really wasn't great to start off with.
Sure.
It wasn't like, this is the epitome of video games.
I think what I dislike about the game, like I think in terms of just being like a collectible, capture gems, be on your little teams, I think that's cool. I think that alone is fine as an application. What makes me mad is that Pokemon has always been about going out in the world, exploring... capturing Pokemon, battling, and training. And I know that they're supposedly going to add battling and training in the future. That's great. But, like, what upsets me is I live, you know, out by a lake a little bit outside of town. There's hardly any Pokemon out here. But if I go downtown, there's a ton of Pokemon. That doesn't make sense to me. Pokemon live in the wild. So if I'm out in the wild, I should be finding Pokemon. But I'm not. I find them when I go to places where people live. That's not how Pokemon works.
It's like, based around the Ingress engine, so it's gonna do.
Yeah,
that,
I know.
But
I know. But like that's something I wish they would improve. They'd be like, look, if you have cell signal and you're out in the middle of a field, you should be finding Pokemon that are in fields. You should not find field Pokemon in the middle of downtown where there's not even a tree. Like it doesn't make it just field it confuses Pokemon. Me.
You can only get Alola Pokemon if you go to Hawaii.
That's the only thing that upsets me about Pokemon Go. Otherwise, I don't really care that like they made it so like the tracking, I guess, is harder now or something, and they broke a bunch of third-party apps. Like, I don't really care about that stuff.
I think it all makes sense, but that's for another time, another place.
Yeah, so as HFK originally brought up, a Pokemon MMO needs to happen. I don't even care if it connects to Pokemon Go, but like just it needs to happen. I've been wanting it since I was a kid. They already fulfilled my catching Pokemon in real life, as they say. So now I want my Pokemon MMO. What if... So I can go to HMK's gym online and kick his ass.
Oh, yo, you want some of this.
I want some. My team's going to be better.
Dude, what if it was a mystery dungeon MMO? You can't handle this.
Yeah, it's because you're going to use hacks.
I'm not going to use no... Man, what do I look like? One of those people who complain from Blizzard when it's all like, hey, man, I'm using aimbots. Get banned.
Please. I was in the battlegrounds. You're using a bot. oh, wow. I still play once in a while.
It's okay, Nate. It's okay.
I know.
You can cry.
It's the game that just, every time a new expansion pack comes out, it just sucks me back in. all right, so his last, the last question he said, or last topic, I'll call this one a topic, not really a question. What do we think, really, of the potential of a future Zelda game in virtual reality? Could it be fun?
No.
No.
Maybe. I couldn't picture that happening.
I think until virtual reality, we've talked about it briefly before. I don't think virtual reality is ready. And when I say ready, I'm mostly talking about the requirements to play it, not the hardware, but the space you need. A lot of people just don't have that kind of space in their home, especially to play uninterrupted. And I think, you have a wire running from your headset and stuff. It just doesn't work well. I know, there's phone options. Like, Samsung's got the little thing. That's not the same. That's not to me, that's not real virtual reality. I've tried it. It's not even close to as good as, Oculus or Vive. The problem is that I don't think there's a single game out there right now that proves why virtual reality creates a better game.
I would disagree.
There are demos that show a lot of promise. But I've watched, probably at least 150 different VR games because I want to love VR. The whole idea of virtual reality just, it's there. I love it. But, I watch all these demos and they look awesome. But they're overpriced, they're not very long, and they're not complete. And it doesn't sound like they'll ever be complete. Because their idea is just for you to play it for a little bit, get that, oh, that's cool feeling, and sell you on that. It's kind of like what the Wii did, to be honest. Gave you that, oh, that's cool. I swung my thing, and my guy on the screen swung his racket. That's cool. And then you kind of get bored of it, and you get past it. And I kind of think that's what's going to happen with all these virtual reality games. I don't think... I could be wrong. I have not personally seen a VR game that looks complete and tells me that I need to own VR to play this amazing game. But that's just me. Obviously, wearing a virtual reality headset as I'm watching people play this, but I watch these videos, and I'm like, they look cool. I've used VR headsets. I think these demos are cool. They're really short. They're $40 a piece. That's not attractive to me. And I've seen the Zelda games in VR, Zelda 1 in VR, Ocarina of Time in VR. Those look cool, but it doesn't, I need to see someone take a full AAA game and build it around the concept of VR before I could really believe that Zelda could work and be fun in VR.
See, what and I totally agree.
What I could see the proof for that game being is IBM Japan's doing that whole Sword Art Online, standalone experience thing. Hopefully based on how that does, they decide to take it further because that'd be freaking awesome. But seeing something like that and seeing if that actually does well, if it's actually good, because that would be a legitimate MMORPG adventure game in virtual reality, which would be really cool.
Sure.
That's what, that I think would be what it should. Virtual reality be more than just a short-lived gimmick? I could see it moving towards something like that, whether or not it will.
The coolest thing about virtual reality, from what I have seen so far and experienced, is watching movies. It is amazing watching movies in VR. It's almost better than going to a movie theater. It is awesome.
I don't know. That's...
I don't know. I agree with Nate on that. Because it's if you get the right software for it, it's you're actually in the movie theater. And you can look around. No one's around you. You can look up at the screen. you know, you can pan left, pan right. I don't know. I'm with
you.
You
can actually
that.
Create the, you know, like the IMAX theater, how like the screen's all around you. Yeah. You could do that in VR.
Can't right you do that home. Right now on Steam with Hardcore Henry? Because I know I know they released it on Steam, and I know that it's VR. I think it's VR compatible.
Yeah, maybe. I don't have a VR headset here to test that, but yeah, that I mean, it's entirely possible. So like, I don't know. I mean, the thing is I want to love VR. I don't love it right now. A lot of people that have VR units that have played hundreds of games on them spent all the money on it because, you know, they have an audience that cares about what they think about these games, are not impressed. They think there's a lot of cool ideas, zero complete games. And that's what's really weird about these platform launches. Imagine that the NX launches and all it is a bunch of game demos. And they want $40 per demo.
Ugh.
Like, that does not sound like something that people want, right? And that's basically what VR is doing right now. It's we're releasing these super expensive platforms that if you want the best of it, you need a whole bunch of space, you got to inconvenience yourself. It's probably like $1,000 bare minimum for you to even get in on the ground floor with decent VR. And we don't even have full games to give you. We just have ideas that cost a lot of money.
Oh boy.
That's why I'm scared for VR. I think it's great. I don't think it's ready. I think it's being rushed to market before the software is there.
Well, and Nintendo's wise to wait for proof of VR to work before they even
dive in. Yeah,
yeah, right. Like because they've
like
seen,
Nintendo's played VR. Yeah. They just they've said themselves they don't think it's ready.
That the Virtual Boy.
Have you ever used the Virtual Boy before? It is not virtual at all. Oh man. I mean, maybe no. You know what? No. Even back then, they had better virtual reality than that.
Yeah.
That was not. I appreciate that they thought it would, you know, that they were exploring virtual reality. But man, I don't know who at Nintendo saw that and like, yeah, we just gotta rush that out.
This needs like to that, happen.
This
now.
Is right. It's gonna be a big seller. Anyways, so we're gonna just quickly. We'll spend about 5 minutes here. Just talking about our favorite things that happened in video games this last week. For HMK, who probably doesn't know, this could be like a favorite game you played. It could be a favorite piece of news. It could be about anything, not just Zelda, like anything in gaming. Let's start with Trey, since little Trey over there is a bit silent today.
I've been playing, I mean, this is news, not really. I've been playing Overwatch again. They just updated it where it's Rio. It's the
Trey
Rio pack.
Playing Overwatch?
Yeah, see that.
I know, right? What? they just updated it with the Rio pack, so you could play with the different like, well, the Rio games is the new Olympic game, so they have like different like costumes and emotes and stuff. So
did
I'm
they
just
add
like
the Zika virus.
Oh boy.
Oh man. Oh. but you know, I'm just trying to like get in, play, get loot boxes and get all the rare stuff before it goes away, I think, at the end of the month. So I've been playing
and
that
and I still
nonstop.
Have not turned Overwatch on since the last time I played it with Alfred.
Play it this month, man. Rio stuff. Olympic
I just,
games.
I know once I play, that's all I'm going to do that day.
Yeah, it's too addicting. It's too addicting.
I wish I had more time. Let's go with Alfred. What's your favorite thing from the past week?
So I've been playing Civ 5. And I've never played a Civ game before, but Zachy,
it's a good one to start with.
He got it for the Humble Bundle and gave it to me, and I can't stop playing. Nate, I'm addicted.
That is a very good Civ game to start with.
It's bad. We drove to San Antonio today for family vacation, and I was supposed to be driving, and I did, but I was up till about 4 a.m. playing Civ 5. I could not stop. I was at war with Gandhi. I was destroying India. It was perfect. And
that's all the Civ games work. Civ games, I think my average game of Civ in any of them probably takes anywhere between 15 to 30 hours.
Yeah, it's time consuming.
But that's the way the game is. Like, it's designed that way.
Yeah.
But, and it's very good at it. Like, even though like sometimes it feels like, oh, I'm just rushing through turns, I still don't feel bored. Civ 5, to me, in my opinion, is the best Civ game they've ever released.
It's the best Civ game I've ever played, because I've only played one.
So yeah, like that's cool. Well, I'm glad you're a newfound Civ fan. Maybe you'll pick up 6 when that comes out.
Yeah, but in terms of like game news, 2 things that happened this week. Ooh. I still have yet to play the Batman Telltale series, but that came out today.
Yes, I haven't played that yet.
And I'm probably going to get that tonight after we get off the podcast.
Nice.
And I don't want to talk too long about this, but the new Sun and Moon trailer that was released.
Which one?
The one that with the Z forms.
There's the US one.
With the ice Vulpix.
Yeah, the ice.
Okay, yeah. Stuff.
That sure. That looks kind of cool. And I don't know, because they talked about different islands and stuff, so I wonder if that's going to replace gyms as the league. And I think that'd be really cool. And maybe they're changing, because they talked about changing up the conventions of Pokemon somehow. So if that's what they do, and if it's completely, not completely different, but if that's how they go about it, then I, you know, more power to them. And I am psyched for Sun and Moon.
Nice. HMK.
I was going to say the Sun and Moon thing, because that thing got me really hyped. Because... I was talking to my friends about it, how apparently a lot of the stuff that happened in the trailer got leaked, and everyone on Reddit, everyone on 4chan were shitting on these people who were leaking this stuff, and then now that it's true, everyone's like, oh my god, like, nothing is safe, nothing is real, what is Pokemon? Because, I mean, the notion of existing Pokemon to have different types, you know, that's something they played around with Delta Pokemon, you know, in the card games where, like, Pokemon that we know are different types, like, use, like a Pikachu would be a psychic type or something like that. Now, these Alola forms are basically that, you know, these existing Pokemons in different forms and different types, you know, and Ice Vulpix. A Dragon-type Executor. What? I mean, what is that? So now that we have this, and now that we have a certain trainer got revealed during the trailer, which kind of confirms a leak that was shown off a couple of weeks ago, which the final evolutions of the 3 stars got leaked because in their concept art, the character art of what we saw in the trailer was there. So everyone's like, okay, now the leak is real. So now everyone's going all over the place, and now it's like, what can we expect in Pokemon now? We don't know. Everything's on the table. We have these, like, Dragon Ball Z moves and stuff. We have these Pokemon that are different types. Me and my homeboys were talking about Crystal Onyx could be an Alola Pokemon from the anime. The Pink Butterfree could be an Alola form Pokemon. Everything is there. And Nintendo has not slept on the anime, because a lot of things from the anime are now in the games. And, you know, it's just the level of possibility in a Pokemon game was blown wide open with this trailer. And I love it. So
sure,
that's
one thing. Nice. Pokemon, obviously, is... And well, not obviously for me. I haven't been a big Pokemon fan for a long time. Loved Red, loved Blue, loved Yellow, loved Gold and Silver. After that, I kind of fell away. I didn't like a lot of things they were doing with the series. And I honestly, like, I've tried Pokemon games since. I think I owned Pokemon X. Did own it, sold it, because I didn't really like it. And somehow, watching these trailers, reading the press release, I'm into it again. Something about what they're doing is making Pokemon feel fresh.
A lot.
And I mean, I don't know. I don't know if I'm gonna end up liking the end product. As I said, I have not liked Pokemon games in a while. You know, I hate the fact that there's like 800 different Pokemon. I've always hated it. I thought they ran out of original ideas like 3 generations ago. But it's entertaining enough to me now that it's piqued my interest. And unfortunately, because I have lots of fond memories of Pokemon from when I was a kid, if a Pokemon game piques my interest, I'm going to end up buying a day one. Even if I end up... so far, I've done that for like 3 different other generations, and I regretted it and sold it the same week. But I have hope. This one actually brings me legit hope, because it looks like it's not just a bunch of fancy new graphics and new Pokemon. It's trying to actually take Pokemon what it is fundamentally, almost like Breath of the Wild is doing for Zelda, just kind of turn it on its head and trying a whole bunch of new ideas. And I think that Pokemon has been needing to do this forever. I think a large reason I got bored of it is just it felt like I was just playing the same game I've already played when I was 12. Yeah, there's more mechanics and more of this and that, but it's basically the same game. Except now they don't tell me I got to catch them all, and that was always my funnest part of the game, catch them all. Beating the Elite Four, psh, of course I'm going to kick their butt. But anyways. But since everyone else talking about Pokemon, I'm just going to say my favorite thing that's happening in video games this week is actually today. Today I launched my new initiative, my new project. Something I've talked about on the podcast a couple times before, NintendoPrime.com.
Woo! Woo!
If you're visiting it right now and it's offline, I apologize. I bought really, really crappy server, like a really cheap server for it because I don't have a lot of money. And today, when we're recording this, when we launched, literally an hour after we launched, the entire site went down from traffic. So thank you for coming to my new project and enjoying the news and the original editorials and stuff that I have going on there, all about Nintendo, so I can actually talk about more than just Zelda somewhere. Yay. But, yeah, I'm sorry. I do have a new server. I am working on a transfer. I've been working on it all day today. Probably going to go into tonight as I'm editing the podcast. So hopefully by the time you watch the podcast, it's on a new server and you're never going to experience these problems. But yeah, Nintendo Prime. Like, if you guys want to go check it out, go for it. It covers Nintendo news. It's got editorials. We're going to have a Nintendo Prime podcast on the line. I do cover our Zelda Informer podcast there as well. Just because the Zelda Informer podcast is actually not part of my quote-unquote job at Zelda Informer. It's something I do because I want to do it. And I'm sure that's the same reason you guys are all here with me on the podcast, is because you want to be here and you enjoy talking about Zelda, passionately talking about Zelda. We all know HMK does.
Oh, yeah.
From his channel on Zelda and Kingdom Hearts to the many times I hear your voice on everyone else's theory video.
What?
Well, you never cameo in other videos. Never.
Right? Never.
So anyways, that's all I'm going to say about that. Go check it out. There's a Patreon for it. Patreon.com/NintendoPrime if you're interested. I really don't care if you come support it. Just, hey, it's something I did. If it sucks, tell me it sucks. I'm cool with that. So that's going to do it for this week's podcast. I want to thank our special guest, HMK, for joining us.
No problem. Thank you so much for having me, dude.
Took a few weeks, but hopefully if we have you on again, it doesn't take another few weeks.
Nah, trust me. You know, it was a string of unfortunate events, like the Tuesdays.
Oh, so is that going to be a new movie?
Yes.
A string of unfortunate events. And obviously, thank my co-host, who hopefully will be here until we no longer have a podcast, which will probably be when I die. That's a sad day.
Well, when Zelda dies, I will be in charge of the podcast.
Zelda series, don't die before me. Oh. Like, live on so my children's children's children can play. And obviously, Trey, our magnificent comic artist, who, credit to him, he created the logo for Nintendo Prime. Thanks big time for that.
No problem. It was fun making it.
Yeah.
I loved how it turned out.
All right. Well, thank you, listeners. Yep. Thank you, everyone. You guys have a great weekend, a great week. Adios.
Later days.